Hello, good afternoon and namaste. I hope you're all observing all precautions and staying very safe. I'm Dr. Srinidhi Chidambaram and I'm delighted to welcome you to the COVID care series presented by Apollo Hospitals. Every day we bring you awareness and practical suggestions and advice on COVID-19 from our top specialists from across our hospitals in the country. Many of us, I would say almost all of us, have elders at home, be it parents, grandparents, and one common worry for all of us is how to take care of them and keep them safe during the COVID-19 pandemic. How do we look after them? How can they be protected from catching the infection? Or if they do get it, how do we treat them at home or at hospital? Can we vaccinate them? Which vaccine? What if they have other conditions like cancer or heart disease or diabetes? Should we take them for their regular checkups to the hospital? Is it safe? The questions are never ending. Well, panic never helped to tackle any issue. So let's ask all our questions to our expert today and let's stay calm and cool. Let me also specially welcome any of our senior citizens who have logged in. Namaste. And thank you very much for joining. To discuss our topic of today, I'm delighted to welcome Dr. Vasant Kumar. Dr. Vasant Kumar is a general physician and geriatrician with an experience of over 43 years in these specialties. He practices at Apollo Health City, Jubilee Hills, Hyderabad, and at Apollo Sugar Clinic at Banjara Hills, Hyderabad. He completed his MBBS from the Usmania Medical College, Hyderabad in 1977 and MD in General Medicine from the same university in 1981. He is a member of the Hyderabad Medical Council. Welcome, Doctor, and thank you very much for joining us today to discuss the topic of preventing and managing COVID-19 in senior citizens. I request you to begin by giving us a brief overview about this topic, and after that, we will take up some questions from our viewers.
Thank you, Dr. Srinidhi, for that wonderful introduction. So actually, in spite of the difficult times we are all passing through, I think it's nice that we are able to talk to each other this afternoon on this important topic that Apollo Hospital has chosen. Respected seniors, dear friends, we all know that we are passing through difficult times. It's been going on for over a year, but in the recent few weeks, maybe around 6 weeks, things have worsened in most of the places in India, most of the places where we are living, both in the urban places, metropolitan cities, towns, everywhere. Unfortunately, the pandemic has spread, created havoc, because it's a kind of unprecedented situation that the nation is facing. Although the world faced, but right now India is facing and we are all facing. It's obvious that when we have a situation like this, the elders are even more concerned. Not only the elders, the other family members are concerned about the elders, the youngsters, because we know for many reasons, the elders may have issues, may be more susceptible. These are our concerns and worries all of us have, especially during this pandemic. But I'm not here to make your worries bigger. I'm here to say that I must make one observation, Dr. Srinidhi. If you see during this time of the pandemic, relatively many elders are doing better. That's a good news that I want to share. In fact, I've been having discussions with some of my senior colleagues at the national level. And where we have found out many people, when I'm talking about elders, I'm talking about elders beyond 75, 80, have also been reasonably doing well. They are doing as much as the middle-aged people in many situations, unless, you know, they have very grave health issues and other points. So what I'm trying to say is that We don't need to be unduly worried, but we need to take care of ourselves, just as the people of the rest of the society. Everybody knows about why this pandemic has increased now, because people have been careless. We have not been following the etiquette that we are supposed to follow during the pandemic, especially wearing a mask, wearing it properly. Many people don't wear it properly. And especially when it comes to elders, when I'm talking about elders, I'm not talking about people who are in 60s. I'm talking about people who are much older, because they're the ones who we are even more concerned. Is it not? I'm sure they agree with me. So some of them are very vulnerable people. We are talking more about them, how they need to wear a proper mask, how they need to be mentioned many times. They have to be reminded about it. Because many times if you see very elderly people, sometimes with some kind of a dementia, senility, they don't even understand the importance of it. These are the real vulnerable people whom we need to really worry about them and make sure that they don't go out. When they go out, they go out with very proper masking. And we know, remember one point, we talk about masks so easily. But when we're talking about elder people, wearing a mask properly, covering the nose and mouth, will they be able to walk long distance? No, they won't be able to do that. So we need to make this point very clearly. So we need to specially take care of them compared to others. But these are some of the issues. And of course, everybody knows everything about COVID. Let's not spend too much of time going into the research or the scientific aspect. Let's get into the practical aspects. How do we handle it? How do we prevent it? What are the issues that worry us? Where we should not worry? How we go about it? So that's what I thought I will take this point further. Yes, Srinidhi.
Sure, doctor. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So what today I want to take this time to generally also explain. People have so many doubts, so many apprehensions about this disease, sometimes rightly, sometimes wrongly. Why I'm saying, and also please remember, many patients are undergoing out of panic, unnecessary tests, unnecessary medication, which may not be really good for them. It's not that spending money. It may not be good for you to do that. So I'll just tell about it for a couple of minutes. Suppose if somebody becomes symptomatic. When I say symptomatic, what do I mean? I mean, whenever somebody has slightest fever, only fever, 99 point, please do remember it's very likely to be COVID. What is the first thing we do? Not going for an RT-PCR test. First thing is remain in the room. Be isolated from your spouse, from other elders. That is the first thing you need to do. You're going for an RT-PCR, you'll go. It takes time in this situation, you know. I know how difficult it is for a senior to go for an RT-PCR test, which is an important test to confirm, I agree. But the first thing that I want you to do is remain isolated. If it's not COVID, it's fine. Next 2-3 days, you can come out. But it's very likely to, any kind of a fever is likely to be a COVID fever now. Please remember, don't think that I'm only having slight fever, I don't have cough. No, people need not have cough, people need not have any complaint. They may just have fever less than 100 degrees to start with. Please remember, this disease spreads right from the day one, sometimes even before one develops fever. So that's the right opportunity to isolate the person. So when do we isolate? When you know about it, when you know that COVID can present in this way. Because why I'm emphasizing on this is, I'm emphasizing on stopping the spread of this damn disease, which is, even today, you know the numbers. Numbers are lakhs and thousands in every metropolitan city. How do we do it? Not just go on about talking about it, not talking about oxygen at that level. It's a different thing. Right now, what we need to talk is, how do we control it? Just isolate yourself. Also, please remember, during this pandemic time, it is the spread, intra-family spread, that is increasing the disease. Within the family, whether you are a middle class, upper class, or lower middle class, it easily spreads. If there are 4 people in the house, I see anybody getting spread. So to stop this, this could be one thing. Stay, if you have a separate room, please sleep separately. And then next go for what is called an RT-PCR test, where they do a throat swab. We all know about it. It is a confirmatory test. But I want to tell you, because I'm emphasizing more of the practical points, which probably you may not be aware, is that RT-PCR test generally becomes positive at least 3 days after you develop symptoms. So what's the point in doing on day one? You can be negative, but you can be still a positive, COVID positive person. How do we handle this situation? Everybody wants to get it done, you know, like Matt, go and get an RT-PCR and it comes negative. Do you mean to say that you don't have COVID? No, it can still be COVID if you have symptoms. Please remember this point. So the best thing is do it after 2-3 days, remain isolated, think that you are a COVID patient. It's always better to think like that way so that you protect yourself, your family, your society. Do the test after 3 days. Then the chances of becoming positive if you are a COVID patient becomes higher. Then that's one. Also remember, most of the people who suffer from COVID, even if you're an elder person, you're most likely to come out of it. You just need to be patient, isolate, eat properly. Nothing happens to you in the next 4 or 5 days. Problems start cropping up. Generally what they say in the first week, end of the first week or beginning of the first week. That is say 7th day. In the worst situation, it is 5 days. It's not before that. So many times people may have fever. So they will take some medications which are advised by their doctor. The medications can be kept at a minimum according to me, but it is a doctor's discretion. So 4 or 5 days mild fever, you are very likely to get out of it. If the fever passes beyond 5 or 6 days, apart from the fever, if you have severe cough or your temperatures are high, then that's the time you need to watch. You need to get investigations, see whether things are worsening. You need medical attention. Can you be at home? Do you need oxygen at home? Do you need to go to hospital? That situation arises typically at least 5, 6, or 2nd week of this disease. That's one point we need to very carefully understand. When I told about RT-PCR, I also must want to tell you that you don't need to rush for the investigations. The moment you are RT-PCR positive, don't rush for investigations. At that time, your investigations may not reveal the severity of the disease. The disease is just progressing. Disease takes its time to evolve, show its tentacles, and show it in the blood reports. It takes about 4 or 5 days. So wait during that period, see if your symptoms persist, ask your doctor to do the investigations, take the next step, what you do. So these are some of the very practical things. Some of you may know it, but I'm trying to emphasize because this is the most important aspect according to me. Of course, when things turn out a little uncomfortable, unfavorable to a particular person, after 6 days, 7 days, we always talk about checking the oxygen saturations with pulse oximeters. But you don't need to do it on the day one or two, as I told you. Many people tell you, sir, I developed fever, my oximeter is showing 98, sir. It's showing 99, sir. Okay, you're happy about it, but you never know what's going to happen to you after 5 or 6 days. So concentrate on checking the pulse oximeter after 4 or 5 days, especially for elder people. Do it properly. Don't get panicky. You have somebody in the family, take their help. You have a family doctor, call them. You have a family hospital, call them. There are always people are willing to help you at this juncture, in spite of all the difficult things that are happening around, all the negative things that's happening around. People are still surviving. The mortality is still is 1, only 2%. People have also been talking, Dr. Srinidhi, that has the mortality increased during this pandemic? It has not really increased. But the number of deaths are more, because the number of people who became positive are simply 5 times or even 10 times more than what it was last time. So naturally, if one person out of 100 dies, when you have 10,000 patients, what happens? There are going to be 100 mortalities. So first thing is we have to cut down these numbers. In the next few weeks, we need to work on this, and I'm sure we will get out of this. So So with this, I would ask Dr. Srinidhi to take this forward and see whether we need to address any specific issues, a specific point that she wants to raise, or any questions from any of our participants.
We will shortly look at, thank you, Doctor. We will look at some questions shortly from our viewers. But meanwhile, I was just wanting to ask you about elderly people with diabetes. Now, there is a general view that, anybody with diabetes and COVID generally have a more severe run. So how is it with elderly people? Do you think that they need to have any special precautions, or if they get it, should they be hospitalized?
Yeah, I'm sure you will ask that question. So I was leaving it to you to ask the question. I understand, because every time we are talking about comorbidities, is it not? Everybody is talking about comorbidities. One of the most important comorbidities that elders can have is, like Dr. Srinidhi said, diabetes, hypertension, and cardiovascular disease, or even a kidney disease, or it can be some of the unfortunate people may have some kind of cancer, they're undergoing treatment. So these are some of the comorbids that people may have. Amongst the diabetes is an important thing. Why is it important? Because if you take elders, 25% of you take randomly anybody above the age of 60 will be diabetes. And what has been happening for the last 1 year? We have not been really taking care of our diabetes because we were scared to go to the hospital to visit the doctor. We were hesitant to take an online consultation. We are hesitant to get investigation. So that's an important point now, is that even if you're diabetic, if diabetes is under control, your chances are much better than an uncontrolled diabetic to face the situation. So prevention is better than the cure, as always, everyone says. So if you're a diabetic, be more careful. Don't be under the impression that I'm taking the medication, my sugar will be all right. So many times people have not checked for the last 6 months. And suddenly, when they have a COVID situation, when they go there, the blood glucose is 350, 400 milligrams. And you never know since how long it's been so high. So that's it. That's not a very good situation, especially in COVID. The problem with COVID is, one thing is, if you are already uncontrolled diabetic, COVID itself increases the blood sugars. It changes the metabolism of the body. Your blood sugars can go rise. And one more point that happens in hospitalized patients is that most of the patients who are hospitalized, as I was mentioning in the second week, require steroids. Steroids in the form of tablets or injections are the life-saving drugs. If you ask me, there are two most important life-saving agents. One is the oxygen, the other is steroids. This is what is being given. It is not the remdesivir which saves your life. I am making this categorical statement today. It is a steroid that saves your life. Remdesivir works only for 7-8 days. You can give it in a hospitalized patient. It might reduce the intensity of the disease. But when somebody has a severe disease, so steroids are given. Every physician, pulmonology specialist in our hospitals would choose a judicious combination of steroid and give it to you. So if you're an uncontrolled diabetic, your sugars will further shoot up because steroids are known to shoot up the blood sugars. So it becomes a kind of a cycle which we need to break. One thing is prevention. If you're a diabetic, don't ignore it. Accept it that you're diabetic. Check the sugars at least once or 2 months, especially during this period. You have all the reasons to keep your diabetes, hypertension under control so that you don't end up in a bigger mess. Yeah. So that's important, diabetes.
Doctor, talking about steroids, we also now have this trend of people wanting to take steroids early on in the disease. And we know that that can actually worsen the symptoms, and we are hearing of things like, they get into fungal infections and all that. So could you tell our viewers something about, how not to, overdo or take your own decisions or try to take it too early or anything? That has been quite prevalent. People seem to want to take it earlier so that they think the intensity will come down.
That's true, Srinidhi, because generally people have different kind of impressions about steroids, is it not?
Yeah.
And it's in the purview of a doctor to prescribe new steroids. We need to discuss about steroids to a certain level, not beyond that level, because beyond that level depends on the physician who handles you. But generally, as Dr. Sunil Nidhi asked, steroids are generally avoided during the first 5 or 6 days. So don't, by no means, don't try to take your neighbor prescribed steroid. Please don't take it yourself. It will be very dangerous. So there is a clear-cut role. I mentioned earlier, steroid is a lifesaver. When used judiciously, when used in a proper time, when used in a proper setting. So one is self-consumption of steroid is very dangerous. But just to make it simple, please don't take it during the first 4 or 5 days. No doctor would prescribe you a steroid during that period. It is only some antiviral drugs, symptomatic treatment, vitamins. All kinds of vitamins are being prescribed. You know, they think zinc is helpful, vitamin C is helpful, vitamin D are helpful. But they're all helpful to one extent, to some extent. They're not going to cure your disease. It's your body that cures you. It's your positivity, your proper handling the situation at the right time, not messing up a situation will help you to get over this. So as far as steroids are concerned, they are used during the second week in the hospital. And Dr. Srinidhi has one more particular important point is that what about giving steroids at home? There are some situations where patients have been prescribed oral steroids. Say somebody has a disease at the end of 6 days. There are some of those investigations like CRP or CT scan show a moderate disease and they cannot be shifted. The disease is still moderate. They are not very oxygen dependent. Or somebody has an oxygen concentrator in the house. I'll also come to the point of oxygen concentrator. So in that situation, it is justified in starting a steroid if by a qualified doctor. He will decide about the dose. He also knows what things can go wrong with your steroids. Your diabetes may go up. You need to monitor it. But then it's a balanced, doing an act, a balanced act. But certainly it can be given at a stage. When I talked about oxygen, many of you or some of you have oxygen concentrators at home. They can be handy. People are importing them. But remember, oxygen concentrators give you usually the oxygen up to 5 liters. So it can be useful for very mild people or moderate people. Many of them who get admitted in hospital require higher dose of oxygen. Concentrators won't cater to their needs. We give them with cylinders, with a mask. Most of the oxygen concentrator that you use to the nasal cannula. But in the hospital, you use a mask, you higher oxygen, 10, 15 liters per hour. That's what it goes in, which will not be possible at home. So you need to be careful about, you have an oxygen concentrator? Yes, use it properly. But remember the limitation of it. That's it.
Is there anything else we should discuss before we go into the questions? I think there are about questions are coming in. So I will begin with the questions then, I think.
Because fine.
This is as per what is coming on the FB Live. So my mother is facing sugar up and down. BP is also fluctuating and she has chest pain and feels very weak. She has tested positive on 5th April. Got remdesivir doses. Why is she so weak and why is her chest paining? Her SpO2 is 87. She doesn't have diabetes and she sometimes has low sugar and fluctuating BP. So I think this is a post-COVID situation that they're asking about. And she still feels very weak and there is a chest discomfort.
So she's been I know. It's more than a month.
Yes.
So she's positive. She recovered. Only concern is she has weakness, she has pain, and diabetes is there. And in this situation, don't take it granted that everything, don't attribute everything to COVID. Many times we have seen people developing a cardiac issue, elderly people. So they you need to monitor them for a cardiac issue, especially if somebody has a chest pain. It may be nothing to do with COVID. Although, you may slightly see the increase of the cardiac issues, strokes in post-COVID situations. But that is to a very small extent. In any case, don't ignore this, especially during the post-COVID period. It's the time that you need to consult a specialist doctor, rule out a cardiac problem inside that situation. That's what I can only advise. You cannot give more specific advice than this.
I think this, the mother should be, I think, taken to the doctor for a proper evaluation. The next question is, my parents are having hepatitis B. Can they get the vaccine? So this is also about a general question about elderly and the vaccine as well. Like, you know, there's a lot of doubt. They say if I'm having cancer, I can't take the vaccine or things like that. So a bit of clarity on that would be also useful, doctor.
I know. Vaccination itself is a huge issue. Now, I understand. And then it's obvious that we have many genuine doubts which we need to clarify as far as possible. Generally, if you see even a child when it's born, we give 3-4 shots just on the right at that moment. Is it not? We give a polio shot. Now, polio is available intramuscular. You give a triple antigen. You give a BCG, what is called tuberculosis. So COVID vaccine is a different vaccine. So it doesn't interfere with the other vaccines. Within a day or two, you can receive any other vaccine. That's a blanket answer. And talking about the vaccines, people get a lot of doubts about it, you know. Some of them is that right now we have two vaccines that are available in India. The third one, the Sputnik vaccine, I was told should be available this month. Please remember these, sometimes we have a choice, sometimes we do not have choice between these two vaccines, that is Covishield vaccine and the other one is Covaxin vaccine. So please do not wait for your choice of vaccine or anything. Both vaccines work. Both of them are relatively safe. So go for them. The only difference would be when you're going for a second dose, now it is the Government of India and ICMR has very clearly mandated that after Covishield, the second dose, take it after 6 weeks, that is 1.5 months, to 2 months. You can even wait for 2 months with Covishield. Remember this point. You don't need to be panicky that it's 6 weeks, the vaccine is not available. Don't worry about Covishield. You can take it even before 2 months. That's one. As far as Covaxin is concerned, try to take it 6 weeks. Take it from 4 weeks to 6 weeks. Earlier, it used to be 4 weeks. Now, you can take it anytime before 6 weeks. But it's always better that you need to repeat the same vaccine. Some people ask us, can we shift to the other vaccine? No, it's not, because the mode of action is different. Although both of them work, but the mode of action, the type of antibodies they develop are different. So you go for the second, same type of second vaccine at that particular period. Then another thing is, now people have a lot of doubts, you know, everybody is to clarify, you know, our own people, leaders, including Prime Minister, took it openly so that people understand that it is safe, that everybody can take. Just as in our doctor circle, we talk about, people say that after vaccine, some people are developing clots and other things. So they said, somebody said, there are less than 5 cases of clots in 1 million people who vaccinated. But there are more than 10 cases in 1,000 patients suffering from COVID. So that means COVID is 1,000 times more dangerous. And the vaccine show has very, very negligible kind of a situation. So don't worry about such things. Go for a vaccine. And the other thing is, you asked me some specific things like, who are the people who should not take? Let's put this way. Is it not? In that, I will come to your point also. Many people have skin allergies. They have asthma, other pollen allergy, allergic conditions. It's generally mandated that they can go for the vaccine. But please remember, whenever you are vaccinated, you are made to wait there for 30 minutes. Any such serious situation arises, it arises. Any injection can cause anaphylaxis. Any injection, even a B-complex injection can cause anaphylaxis. So that's why that kind of thing. But you hardly see anybody developing anaphylaxis. By now we have already given tens of millions of doses all over India. Rural areas we are giving every time. So anaphylaxis is an extremely rare situation. So people with allergies, they can take. Only condition they say avoid vaccine is when somebody develop anaphylactic reaction, severe allergic reaction, where their blood pressure fell down, they became unconscious. Following any injection, it's better to avoid vaccine. Very simple, as simple as that. And coming to the patients, serious patients suffering from cancers, for example. Many cancer patients, cancer survivors, they should go for vaccine. Only people who are on active medication of anti-cancer drugs, basically if anti-cancer drugs are, they suppress your immunity. So what happens if you take the vaccine? Nothing dangerous is going to happen. Only thing is your vaccine may be ineffective because of the immunosuppressive drugs that you are taking. You can still go for it. Or you can ask your oncologist or physician whether he wants to reduce or stop some medication. Because some of them are anyway once in a month situation. So depending on the anti-cancer drugs you are taking, you should decide about the vaccine. But blanketly, if you say people suffering from cancer can go for vaccine. Similarly, people suffering from kidney disease should all the more reason for them to go for it. Patients with dialysis nowadays, you see, they're highly prone to develop COVID. So they're the first ones to get vaccine.
Doctor, the next question is, my father is hospitalized and under steroid treatment. He's diabetic, maintaining an oxygen saturation of 92 to 97 without external oxygen. But his CRP and D-dimer is increasing. So is it of concern?
So she's talking about the person who is at home, perhaps?
I think he's hospitalized under steroid treatment, diabetic. Saturation is 92 to 97, no external, without external oxygen.
Yeah,
and but CRP and D-dimer is increasing.
Yeah, it's understandable.
I don't know which day it is or anything like that.
It's understandable. This patient, according to that Srinidhi, he has a moderate disease where the CRP, that is C-reactive protein, must be higher, with D-dimer going up, and oxygen requirement plus minus, maybe not there, maybe there. I don't think one should worry about it. This could be a standard case for a steroid treatment in spite of diabetes and manage diabetes along with that. D-dimer is another issue. D-dimer indicates where you are more prone to develop, the clotting mechanism might increase. So when somebody's D-dimer is say more than 400 or so, they are given some antiplatelet drugs or anticoagulant drugs, which are widely available, simple drugs to be swallowed. They are not risky. So most of the time doctors are prescribing them, both the hospitalized patient as well as patients who are isolated at home. Yes.
I think these kind of specific questions also, we cannot really say anything because we don't know all the details about this particular
case. Exactly.
Or which day of COVID he is in also, we don't know. But
know.
Anyway, we will ask them to also make sure they talk to their doctors in the
exactly.
hospital.
Always.
This is another question. After vaccination, fever persisting for 15 days and no other symptoms, what may be the reason?
Yeah, this is another very tricky situation, actually. I've been seeing myself, many patients.
Yeah, I've also seen a couple
you
of
You also
people.
Must have seen, yeah. What's happening? We are getting vaccinated first dose or even second dose. When you go for a second dose, you're still not fully immune from COVID. It takes two weeks after the second dose, you develop immunity. So during the flu shot, the two things that can happen. You are already a COVID patient in incubation period that you went there. Or during the COVID vaccine, you contacted COVID. Or you contacted COVID soon after you came home. So this 10-day situation, it can be one of them. Is it not?
Yeah, it can be.
You're vaccinated. It's not the vaccine which causes fever for 10 days. The biggest problem is when somebody develops problems 2-3 days after vaccine, you think it's because of the vaccine. Okay, fine. Yes. But if it's continuing for 4 or 5 days, then there is a confusion for you and for your doctor. It can be a COVID situation. So we need to be very careful. When you're going for a vaccine, one thing is protect yourself at the vaccine area.
There is
all
also
the healthcare.
misconception that, you know, after COVID vaccine, you get a COVID positive, which people don't realize that that can never happen really. But there is also a kind of misconception that was going around that, you know, if you take the COVID test after 5 days of fever, just had the vaccine, it will naturally be a false positive. So that's
true.
Another thing. Yes.
I know.
Yes.
I think to clarify that point, Srinidhi, we need to tell that the vaccine does not lead to positive RT-PCR test. It was going on in WhatsApp somewhere.
Yes.
So if you are RT-PCR positive after vaccine, that means it's because of the COVID. It's not because of the vaccine.
Not because of the vaccine.
Yeah, that's an important point.
It's the vaccine recommended for a 60-year-old person with autoimmune disease of scleroderma and CREST syndrome. I guess the answer is
yes. Yes, they can take the vaccine provided if they're on steroids, they need to reduce the dose of steroids. That's the only issue. But the steroids may suppress
and then alter the dose.
Yes.
I think we'll take one more question before we sign off because.
Oh, thank you.
My father chest CT is 12. I assume he means the severity. He's hospitalized and under steroid treatment. He's maintenance. No, I think it's the same person who asked in the beginning. But now he tells the D-dimer is increased to 200 to 550. But I think this is best managed by their treating doctor, right? We don't.
We can only assure them. I don't think it's a very severe disease as of now. I'm sure if you are in the right hands, everything should be fine.
Sure.
Yeah.
So, Doctor, I think we will not take up any more of your time. We have answered a lot of questions. Just a minute. I think there are some. Just one more question, please.
Sure.
My mother, aged 76 years, tested positive on 2nd April. She has variable fever below 100.2. She has chronic colitis. Her reports are normal, but she has a swelling on the stomach and on the chest and her BP is up and down. Why is she having recurrent fever? Is it normal?
No, it may not be COVID related, just as we discussed.
For 2nd April, she tested positive.
It's almost 5 weeks.
Yes.
COVID can lead to a lot of complications, but not persistent low-grade fever like this. So we need to see whether second infection or secondary other problems could have caused. So please don't delay. You need to meet the doctor and take the further advice, further investigation, and make sure that your mother is all right. Yeah.
Sure. Thank you, doctor. So viewers, if you have more queries, please reach out to us through the Facebook Messenger or post them in the comments section. So now we will sign off by thanking Dr. Vasant Kumar for a very, very illuminating and very comprehensive talk about elderly and COVID care. Now I will sign off, but before that, I want to tell you that tomorrow we have the topic of Every Cough is Not COVID, an expert opinion by Dr. Ram Gopalakrishnan, who is a senior consultant of infectious diseases at Apollo Hospitals, Chennai. So meanwhile, till we meet tomorrow, we'll meet tomorrow. But before that, I just want to leave you by saying that continue to take care, take all precautions, and don't forget that SMS, which is sanitize, maintain your social distance, and wear that mask. And as doctor said, please don't wear the mask not covering your nose and mouth properly. It has to fit snugly. It has to cover your nose as well as the mouth. And no, a handkerchief wrapped around your face is not a mask. Do be safe. Take care. And we'll see you tomorrow. Thank you, doctor. And
thank you.
All of you. Namaste.